Hello and welcome. You're logged into the fifth of six strawberry webinars sponsored by the North American Strawberry Growers Association and hosted by Cornell University Department of Horticulture and Cornell Cooperative Extension. My name is Kathy Heidenreich and I will be your moderator for this webinar. We'll be starting in just a few minutes. I would like to point out to you, if you were not able to see last week's webinars by Mr. Steve Koike and Dr. Tracy Leske, you can go to the webinar link here in the web links box, and they have both been recorded and are there for you to listen to at your convenience. Dr. Leske was kind enough to provide some information in response to a question by one of the participants about trap construction for brown marmorated stink bug and the availability of commercial traps, and those documents are down here in the files box. The pyramid trap construction is a plan to build your own, and you can download those files, click on the file and then click download. And the other is some information about a commercial trap that's being distributed by AgBio. All right then. Our first speaker today is Dr. Robert Martin. Bob is research plant pathologist with the USDA ARS Horticultural Crops Research Unit in Corvallis, Oregon. He works on virus diseases of small fruit crops. Bob serves as research leader for the unit, which has 66 permanent employees, including 15 research scientists, and is a courtesy professor in the Department of Botany and Plant Pathology at Oregon State University. Research in Bob's lab focuses on characterization, detection, and management of viruses in berry crops. As one of the few laboratories that concentrate on viruses in these crops, he is involved in research on berry crops in most U.S. production areas. Currently, Bob's research focuses on virus complexes and how to control virus diseases in berry crops in the field. His lab is also involved in the National Clean Plant Network and serves as one of the centers for producing virus-tested materials that are then made available to nurseries for propagation. Bob works closely with growers and presents his research and his applications to grower groups throughout the country. Bob?
Okay. Good morning, everybody. Thanks for signing on. I'm going to talk about viruses, which is my favorite topic, in case you haven't heard me speak before. That's about the only thing I give talks on. And at the bottom here is my email and phone number. If you would like to get more information afterwards, feel free to send me an email. It's very simple. It's just my first and last name with a dot and then at arsusda.gov. So with that, we will get started. And before I start, I would like to acknowledge the people involved in the project in case I run out of time at the end. Yadis Chanatakis is a former student and postdoc in my lab, now at the University of Arkansas Fayetteville, and works on viruses and berry crops, and has talked about, did a lot of this work when he was in my lab, and is working on doing a lot on blackberries right now, and blueberries. And Pamela is a student that was in my lab from Chile. The next five people are technicians that have been in my lab. On the right-hand side, we have collaborators, Mark Bolden, Dan Markham from the UC Extension, both involved with strawberries. Bill Wintermantle at Salinas with ARS did the whitefly transmission work. Mark Sweeney was our cooperator up in British Columbia. We got some of the material we'll be talking about from the germplasm repository. And we have samples sent from a lot of different locations around North America. And we also have, at any one time, we have between 4 and 6 undergrads working in the lab that actually keep everything going. And we wouldn't be able to do this without funding from a number of sources. Of course, the USDA pays my salary and some of the technician salaries. The California, British Columbia, North American strawberry growers, the Oregon and Washington growers, and then the Northwest Center for Small Fruit. So we get funding from a number of different sources, which is necessary to keep the program running at the size we have it. And in case you feel left out, feel free to contact me. You can make a significant donation and have your name added to that list. So, strawberry viruses. Most strawberry cultivars that are grown today will not show any symptoms if they're infected by a single virus. And a lot of the cultivars we grow won't show symptoms if they're infected with two or three viruses, depending on what those viruses are. So the breeders have been doing a pretty good job about developing tolerance. Now the drawback to that is if you have a tolerant cultivar, you have one plant that has virus A, one with B and C. In the nursery, they're all symptomless, and over time, those will get mixed together and you can then get disease. Visual symptoms usually, like I said, don't develop unless there's an accumulation of viruses, and some of the material we'll see later, we didn't see those symptoms until we had four viruses present. We use indicator plants. The indicator plants are really only used in the certification and the Clean Plant Network program. That's really sort of our gold standard to pick up unknowns or to detect viruses where we don't have good lab tests. But it also is a backup for any of the lab tests that we do. And what we used to call severe strains of viruses, and I'll show you one of these, now that we have good lab tests and good characterization, we realize that many of these, that actually I think all of these that we've looked at now are actually mixed infections rather than severe infections or severe isolates of a specific virus. These are just examples of grafting. On the top, we have strawberry mild yellow edge. On the lower part, strawberry vein banding. You can see the yellowing along the veins. And then strawberry mottle on the top left. And then strawberry crinkle. And those four are all aphid-borne. And then here's an example of what we used to call severe mottle. Severe strawberry mottle, it's actually strawberry mottle plus pallidosis and I believe beet pseudoyellas. So there's actually a complex there. And all of these viruses are transmitted by the aphid Chaetosiphon fragifoli, which is the common strawberry aphid that we see. And what you'll see on the pointer here, on the hairs along the back of this aphid, there's little bulbs on the top of each hair. And that's a very distinctive feature I've never seen in any other aphid. Normally, this is the only aphid you'll see on strawberry. Occasionally, you'll see the green peach aphid, which doesn't have those bulbous structures at the end of the hair. And it's a light green aphid, similar in color. But the green peach aphid only transmits one or two of these viruses and is not going to cause a disease complex in your field because it doesn't transmit strawberry mild yellow edge or strawberry crinkle. And the other one we see occasionally is the cotton aphid or the Aphis gossypii or Aphis fabi, the black bean aphid. And again, those aphids we don't see very frequently, but they only transmit one or two of the viruses and aren't going to cause a complex if that's the only aphid there, a virus complex, because they don't transmit some of these important aphid-transmitted viruses. So, you know, knowing what the vector is, just because you see an aphid, check to make sure it's Chaetosiphon before you get too excited about controlling the aphid to prevent virus movement. So what really started a lot of this research was a serious strawberry decline problem that showed up initially in British Columbia in the cultivar Totem. It showed up in the year 2000. They called it their Y2K disease. And Totem is a cultivar that was released back in the 70s. And one of the features it had, it was virus tolerant. We could have strawberry mild yellow edge, mottle, and vein banding, and it never showed any symptoms. In an adjacent field, a hood cultivar, for example, would be completely decimated with the same virus complex, and Totem would be fine. But in 2000, we started seeing virus-like symptoms in Totem, which we'll come back to. And then in 2002 and 2003, there was a severe decline in strawberry production areas in California, in the Watsonville area, and down in the Oxnard area, and as well as in northern Washington and British Columbia. You know, I'm located in Oregon. We didn't really have a big problem in Oregon. And the reason we didn't have that big problem in Oregon is we don't have white flies, or they're very, very rare to see a white fly in a strawberry field. And we don't get very many aphids because our summers are so dry. So we don't have the two major vectors are very low populations in our area. And the disease continues to be a problem in the Pacific Northwest. We know what the viruses are, and we know how to control that, and I'll show you an example of that in a bit. But it takes a very coordinated effort because in the Northwest, we have a perennial cropping system. The plants are in the field 3 to 4 years. So everybody has to be on the same page as far as control, and they have to do it for 3 or 4 years to get rid of the inoculum. And it's hard to get that coordinated control strategy implemented because everybody has to buy into it. So this is an example of strawberries in California. This was in 2003 when I first went down and looked at it. And if you were on the call last week, you saw Steve Koike's images of charcoal rot and fusarium rot where they had complete collapse. And this looks a little bit like that, but if you look up close, the plants actually become stunted, discolored, and eventually they might die. But this is in a breeder trial. You see down below here, you see that you've got stunted plants alongside healthy-looking plants. The same thing over here. So it's not a complete collapse like we saw with Steve Koike's talk last week on the charcoal rot and fusarium rot. So it's a different beast. And then also you'll see on the lower right here the white flies. When I was walking through those strawberry fields in California, virtually every leaf had white flies on it, which is a real surprise to me because we had never seen white flies on strawberries in Oregon. And this is the Y2K disease they talk about up in British Columbia. And these are totem plants. And again, what they're seeing is a lot of reddening of the veins, curling of the leaves, and even the very large lesions you see on the lower right here on the petioles, highly distorted leaves. And on the lower left here, this is a field about 1 year after planting. It has not been, the first crop is just getting ready to be picked on here. So this field has not been harvested yet. So in that area, a number of growers consider quit growing strawberries because of this problem. And this is another cultivar in Puget Summer, again, one that's very virus tolerant, had been doing very well, but about 2000, we started seeing a lot of collapse in these plants prior to the first crop being even picked. And it's a virus complex that's showing up, that's present in those fields. So with these two examples of strawberry decline, we started looking in Washington and British Columbia. We found lots of aphids, the Ketocyphon fragifolia, the common strawberry aphid. In California, there were many fewer aphids. So what's the role of each of the viruses, and are there other viruses involved in this complex? So we set out to first identify which viruses were present, and we made a concerted effort to develop a lab diagnostic assay for all of the known viruses of strawberry. And then after that, we did a survey, which we actually still continue to add to. This is on the top left. We have pallidosis. You graft it into Fragaria virginiana. If the plants are growing really well, you know, you could differentiate that. If the plants aren't growing that well in the greenhouse, they sort of look that way anyway. It's a tough one to call sometimes. And on the lower right, we have strawberry necrotic shock virus. And when you see this symptom after grafting, it's very dramatic. But you get that symptom on one leaflet as it's emerging, and all the leaves subsequent to that look healthy. So if you graft and don't look at it for 6 weeks, you would never notice that, you would never know that symptom existed. So you have to watch these on a weekly basis or every 2 weeks to be able to catch that symptom. And these are some samples we got from the repository. Leaf roll virus, I'd never seen this in the field, a chlorotic fleck. But when we wanted to make diagnostics, we went to the repository to look at their collection of infected plants as well. So one of the things we found initially was that there were a number of whitefly transmitted viruses present in California at relatively high incidence. The strawberry pallidosis and beet sooty yellows were very high incidence in 2003 when they had a serious collapse. Up to 90% of the plants were infected with one or both of these viruses. And strawberry crinivirus 3 and 4, those are new additional criniviruses which should be whitefly transmitted. We haven't sequenced the entire virus, but they're present in the field as well. And if you have a strawberry plant infected with all four of these viruses, it does not show any symptoms. But it makes them very susceptible to the aphid transmitted viruses, or very not susceptible, but one aphid transmissible virus comes in there, and then the virus collapses, the plant collapses. So these prime the plant to be extremely sensitive to the aphid transmitted viruses. And these viruses, white flies are, they're moving all the time in the field, they're strong flyers, so these things can spread very quickly in the field. And with the strawberry pallidosis, working with Bill Wintermantle, we did some transmission studies, and basically took the white flies would have to be on those plants for about 6 hours before they could acquire virus. You know, 6 to 12 hours before there was any transmission. So it's not something that they move very quickly. They feed a little bit and move again. In those very short feeds, they're not transmitting viruses. They have to settle down and they have to actually probe deep enough to feed in the phloem tissue. These viruses are associated with phloem tissue, so they have to sit there and feed for a while. That's why it takes so long for the white flies to acquire the virus. And the same is true for transmission. Once they acquire the virus and they move to a new plant, it takes 12 hours in this case before they were able to transmit, which means that insecticides may be effective because there's the white flies have to be there for a fairly long time before they can transmit. And the transmission efficiencies, and this is interesting because in the experimental conditions, Beet pseudoyellus was transmitted much more effectively or efficiently than pallidosis. But in the field, pallidosis was usually much more common. So again, those greenhouse studies don't exactly match with what we're seeing in the field. And this is the host range. This is the interesting ones here are the Malva and the Urtica, which are basically weeds in the weeds found in the perimeters of the field, strawberry fields in California. But it doesn't seem like these are important sources of inoculum for these viruses. But they can be infected and the white flies will feed on those. Beet pseudoyellus has been known for a long time. It has a very broad host range. Transmitted by the same white fly. And now if we look at the aphid transmitted viruses, the first four viruses on this list are the most common ones that we see. And those are the four viruses that really make up the complex that we see in northern Washington and into British Columbia. And the thing that's changed in that complex up there in 2000, prior to that we never saw strawberry crinkle virus in northern Washington and British Columbia. Now it is probably the most common virus we see up there. Why the big shift? We're not sure. It's the same aphid species. Is it a new biotype of aphid, a new strain of the virus? That's up for debate. But this virus is the one that is the new virus added to that mix when we start seeing the decline in totem and other strawberries growing up there. Now the good news is that strawberry crinkle virus, once the aphid picks up the virus, it doesn't transmit for about 3 weeks. So there's a lot of time for intervention to control that virus. And if you're growing strawberries for fruit, you don't need to control all four of those. You just need to control enough of those so you don't get disease. And if you have totem and you can control crinkle, you control the disease. So for the fruit grower, you just want the plants to do well and look well and not have disease. If they have a virus or two that are symptomless, it doesn't really matter. In a nursery situation, we want the plants all to be virus-free if possible, because you don't know where those plants are going to go and you don't want to introduce a virus into a new area. Strawberry chlorotic fleck is aphid transmitted. It's one we haven't seen in the field. Latency and strawberry pseudomild yellow edge. I report in the literature, I've never seen those in the field, but we do not have isolates of those to work with, so those two we do not have lab tests for. And the other thing about these viruses, they have very narrow host ranges. Those first four viruses pretty much only go to strawberry, and they're primarily transmitted by the strawberry aphid. The strawberry aphid is very, very finicky in that it will feed on strawberry and starve to death on almost anything else. That's where a coordinated control effort, if everybody sprays their strawberry fields for 3 years, we could get rid of the inoculum because that these viruses aren't hanging out in the native vegetation, and the aphids aren't out there in the native vegetation. They're going from one field to the next, and every time somebody plants a new field, you've got inocula moving in from older fields. So these viruses cause more problems than any other group. They always seem to be an important component. The white fly transmitted viruses by themselves don't seem to cause disease, transmitted by ketocyphon fragifolate, and that persistent transmission with strawberry crinkle is a critical piece of information because there's such a long latent period, which means we have a lot of time for intervention. And they're also the best characterized of the viruses in strawberry. And I mentioned that already. We have two viruses that we just don't have isolates for. We graft index everything in the Clean Plant Program, so these will show up if they're there, but we don't have lab tests. Nematode-transmitted viruses. In North American strawberry, we really only see tomato ring spot virus, and we see it very, very rarely. The reason is these nematodes don't move very quickly. We've got good nematicides that people have been using, either soil fumigation or other nematicides. So the incidence of these viruses has really gone down in North America and Europe and other parts of the world as well because of the use of chemicals. And also in the annual cropping system, which is very common in many production areas now, these plants aren't in the ground long enough for the nematodes to really get there, do the infection, and cause much disease. Okay, they're generally not important in these short life cycle crops, but in things like raspberry, blackberry, and blueberry, they can be very important. Tomato ring spot in raspberry, for us, can be a big problem. In the southeast, tomato ring spot and blackberry is a big problem, and blueberry is susceptible to both. If we lose our soil fumigants and nematicides, these may become a problem in the future, especially in areas where we've got the matted row perennial cropping system. The ILAR viruses, there's four of these. These are pollen-borne, and apple mosaic is very, very rare. Chiloensis, Fragaria chiloensis virus, primarily restricted to South America from chiloensis plants that came from Chile. We've seen a few positive plants in the northeastern part of the U.S. or southeastern Canada up in the Great Lakes region. Strawberry necrotic shock and tobacco streak are often used as synonyms. Strawberry necrotic shock is usually the one that we see in strawberry. You get a severe reaction, the plants recover. Again, we don't see them as major problems. But for the nurseries, we want to make sure that we're not distributing these anywhere. And again, necrotic shock virus and tobacco streak are very similar. The antibodies we have will pick up both. And we have PCR tests that will pick up both in a single test. And if people wish to, we can differentiate by PCR. For the most part, we're interested in detection and elimination. And necrotic shock is the most widespread. TSV, tobacco streak, actually is very rare, but the test will pick up both. So this is our detection for strawberry viruses as we see it now. And if you look down the right-hand column, you'll see we have ELISA or PCR tests for almost all of these, with the exception of, we should have strawberry pseudomyeled yellow edge in there. There is an ELISA test for pseudomyeled yellow edge that came out of Japan. And we're missing the strawberry latent C. And strawberry feather leaf, we don't have an isolate. But most of the tests now, most of the viruses, we have good laboratory tests. And these are done in conjunction with grafting and other tests when we're doing our assays. This is just a slide of a PCR test for 14 different viruses in strawberry. And this is just to show that we still do, especially for the clean plant net, for the clean plants, before a cultivar is released, we want to test it to make sure it's free of all known viruses. So we do the grafting, we do PCR, we do ELISA, we do all the tests we can before we would suggest that plant be released to the industry. And if any virus is present, we'll go through thermal therapy and produce plants free of the virus. So over the last, 8 years now, 7, we've been doing a survey. And if we look at decline, when we see symptoms in California, you see here we have high incidence of B. pseudoyellos and pallidosis. Those are the white fly transmitted viruses. We also have some mild aphid transmitted viruses. Let's grab that arrow. So we do see some of the aphid transmitted viruses. And when we have declining plants, there's always at least one of the aphid transmitted viruses there. If we look at symptomless plants in California, we see a few, but none of these plants actually showed symptoms in this first column. So if you have one virus or two viruses, some of these have three or four viruses, but they're still symptomless. And when we're looking at these declining plants, we found as many as seven viruses in a single plant on some occasions. And if we look at the Pacific Northwest, especially Washington and Oregon, we have very high levels of the aphid-transmitted viruses, strawberry vein banding, and the aphid-transmitted viruses, very low levels, if any, of the whitefly-transmitted viruses, and a little bit of strawberry necrotic shock. But it's really the aphid-transmitted viruses in the Pacific Northwest that are causing our problem. If we go to the Midwest, you see very few of the whitefly-transmitted viruses, very few of the aphid-transmitted viruses. And in the case of the Midwest, we have fields that are 6 years old where there's very little virus present. So the disease pressure because of vectors is very, very low in the Midwest. And this is Minnesota, Wisconsin. As you start moving east of there, you get the air currents coming up from the Gulf Stream, and you start seeing, you'll see more viruses. If you look at the Northeast, we see a lot more of the whitefly-transmitted viruses. In the Northeast, we don't see a lot of aphid-transmitted viruses in the Northeast. It's a little bit surprising to me, but we've done a lot of testing out of there, and the whitefly-transmitted viruses seem to be much more common. And talking to growers back there and extension people, they said that they do see whitefly, so maybe it shouldn't be so surprising. I'm going to try to move along here. What are control options? We can do biotechnology. Try to look at resistance genes and move those into desired cultivars or engineer resistance through genetic engineering. Probably not going to be happening in the near future, or as it happens, it's not going to be accepted for commercial publication. Really, our control options are based on management. Vector control. Know what the vectors are. So in our area in the Northwest, aphids are the vector of concern. In California, it's aphids and white flies. On the East Coast, it's more of the white flies, not very many aphids. You no need to get rid of all of the vectors. If you get rid of the aphids in California and you let the white fly transmitted viruses go, you're not going to have disease. So aphids are much easier to control because they have such a narrow host range. But if you're doing vector control, remember chemical rotation is extremely important. We don't want to develop resistance to one or two of the chemicals. If we limit ourselves to a few chemicals, then pretty soon they become ineffective. And isolation can be very effective. So we found several new viruses, developed diagnostics, and really in California really worked with the nurseries. And once we realized there were whitefly transmitted viruses, and they made efforts to control viruses, control vectors in the nursery, the problem was pretty much disappeared from the production fields. And this is an example in British Columbia. It's a one-year-old planting, has not yet been harvested, no vector control. This is right across the street, directly across the street, vector control, first year planting, and the plants look beautiful. At beginning of the third year, these plants still look beautiful because they're doing good vector control. But the thing is, they have to do that vector control every year unless the entire area gets on board and does it collectively. With a good collective effort, I think they could get rid of the inoculum up there and then need to do very little vector control. This is an example of isolation. This is on Rifle Island up in British Columbia in the Fraser River. It's the only strawberry field on the island, and west of that island is the Pacific Ocean. So there's no inoculum coming in, And this is a four-year-old field, no vector control, lots of aphids, but no virus. So vector management, again, once we knew white flies were an issue, and the nursery managers were aggressive about controlling the white flies, it improved aphid control, but it also meant there were the plants coming out of the nurseries didn't have those white fly transmitted viruses. And as a result, the fruit growers in California on the annual cropping system didn't really have a collapse problem anymore. So by controlling the viruses in the nurseries, the fruit growers didn't have to worry about the disease. This is an example of looking at nurseries after the vector control was implemented. So out of 400 samples, we tested each sample for 9 viruses. We had 2 positives. So very little disease present in the nursery, no aphids observed, and so we would expect very little disease the following year in production fields, and that's pretty much what we found. I'm working with Mark Bolda, who's speaking next. He collected samples for us, and we could see that even in these production fields, the virus incidence increased over time, so that by the end of the season, there was a fair amount of virus present, but the complexes were so minimal, if at all, there were no symptoms. So even though there's some virus in these fruiting fields, there's no disease. And for the fruit grower, that's what you're worried about. You're worried about disease plants. If there's a virus there but not causing a problem, there's no need to worry about controlling it. A little bit about prokaryotes, phytoplasmas. In the U.S., it's really phytoplasmas. I've never seen them in the Northwest. If they're in California, they're very rare. They're most common in the Florida. Whoops. In Florida. Let's see if we grab that. In the south, in Florida. But it's usually less than about 0.5%. It probably comes in on nursery stock. Occasionally they get higher percentages, and then that could be an issue. But generally they're not a problem. They're a minor problem. They can be detected by PCR. It's an example of some symptoms you'll see with phytoplasmas. This is the bacterial disease candidate. It's Flammobacter, which is common. We find in France and Spain. We haven't seen it here, but it causes a general collapse of the plants. Looks a lot like phytoplasmas, but is caused by a bacteria. This you can come back to. I think we're running out of time here. So virus control, start with clean plants. That's the most critical thing you can do. Know the risk, the high-risk viruses for your area. What are the vectors that are present? And that's really what the risks are. The risks are based on the vectors common in your area. For us, we know it's aphids. In the Northeast, it's more likely to be white flies. In the annual cropping systems, if you start with clean plants, viruses should not be a problem. Know the risk associated with planting sites. That probably comes true. That's also true, like Steve Koike talked about, with charcoal rot and fusarium rot. But if we have a really high nematode population and there were a crop in there previously that had tomato ring spot, you might want to not put strawberries there. Isolation from other fields, if practical. In Watsonville area, that is not very practical. In many parts of the country, it probably is. If there's no strawberries nearby, those aphid-transmitted viruses only go to strawberry. The vectors only on strawberry. So if you're isolated, you're pretty well protected from those. Implement vector control as needed, but be sure you know what the problem is before you take control action. If you've got charcoal rot, spraying for aphids to control viruses isn't going to do much good. Isn't going to do any good, except maybe make you feel like you did something, but as far as having effect, it's not going to happen. And this is an example of know what the problem is. This, you know, you've got weak plants in here. It could easily be similar to what we looked at in British Columbia. But this field, there's not virus present. What we have are areas that are heavily infested with weevils, and we also have cyclamen mite. So again, spraying this field for aphids will probably control the cyclamen mites. It's not going to do much for the weevils. But you're not addressing the real problem. And this is just a reminder to myself that Not all diseases are called by viruses. This is actually drought. So with that, I think I'm going to turn it over to Kathy. And let's see if there's...
Okay, are there any questions for Bob? Any questions? Okay, I'm going to introduce our next speaker, and if you have questions for Bob, be sure you put them into the chat box, and then we'll go through that at the end. Okay, our next speaker is Mr. Mark Bolda. Mark has been the Caneberry and Strawberry Farm Advisor in Santa Cruz, Monterey, and San Benito counties since 2002. He graduated from the University of Illinois in 1989, after which he served in the United States Peace Corps in Paraguay as an agricultural extensionist from 1989 to 1993. He earned his master's degree in plant protection and pest management from UC Davis in 1996 and worked with Plant Sciences, Inc. as a research associate and manager from 1996 to 2002. Mark's going to speak to us on spotted wing Drosophila. Mark?
Yeah, morning. Morning, Kathy. Can everybody hear me good? Can you hear me?
It sounds good to me.
Okay, great. Again, thank you, Kathy, for the introduction. So I'm going to spend the next 20 minutes or so speaking about spotted wing Drosophila, which over the last 2 years has become a pest of significant importance in the berry industries on the West Coast, and I think will be the same case on the East Coast as well. The work I'm going to present here, I'm the guy speaking, but there are other people that I did this work with. The first couple of years I worked with Ed Schoh from Driscoll Research Associates, and I'm also now working with a colleague, Kelly Hamby from UC Davis, in the continuing years as well. So spotted wing Drosophila, so you know what I'm talking about here. This is a picture of the male fly on raspberries. It's rather famous photo. You can see the flies right on a raspberry, and you see the two spots on the back. I can't get this pointer to work. Oh, there it is. Okay, you can see the two spots on the back of the wings. This is only in the male spotted wing Drosophila. The females do not have that spot, but the spots on the back of the wings of the male are fairly diagnostic. Why do we worry about spotted wing Drosophila? The problem first emerged in raspberries, and it continues to be a major problem in raspberries in our industry. You can see this is a piece of raspberry that looked like the one in the previous picture. Opened it up, and you can see right here, you see there's one larva, and then there's another one right there. This raspberry looked sound from the outside, yet when you open it up, you have a larvae, or to the street, those would be maggots, and that is unacceptable in the fresh fruit industry. So this has been our challenge over the past 2 years and continues to be so for the next coming years as well. What is the history of spotted wing Drosophila, or SWD, as we have been abbreviating it lately? We first found it in a strawberry field in August of 2008. Then in September, October, November of the same year, I got many, many calls from raspberry growers complaining of the same thing. Always larvae in the fruit, and a lot of spoiled fruit as well. So it was widely found in strawberry and raspberry fields in the autumn of 2008. I did submit samples to the California Department of Food and Agriculture. Vinegar flies generally are not known to be pests or economic pests. There's about 3,000 species, and only two of them are economic. One of them is spotted wing Drosophila. Be that as may, wasn't identified until we had colossal infestations in cherries in California in the spring of 2009. At that point, I was asked to submit more samples, and it was then identified as spotted wing Drosophila, an invasive pest to the United States. It was new to the United States, actually the continental North America. And then we continued to have the infestations in strawberries and caneberries, of course. Continued to spread to Oregon, Washington, British Columbia, Florida, and then this last year, 2010, up through the eastern seaboard. And then I got a phone call there in November, maybe it was October, Michigan in blueberries, it showed up. So if you don't have it yet, you will very soon. This is important. I want to underline this. Spreading so quickly as it does, there is no regulatory action on this pest. There are no quarantines to speak of on this pest for North American small fruit growers. So when this pest first emerged in our area, I mean, our approach has to be the right one. It's not just go out and spray whatever you can and kill as many flies. We need to take a knowledge-based approach, and of course that is integrated pest management. So it's a three-step process. What we're saying now, again, this is a work in progress, so this is most likely will not be the final word, but this is what's working for us now. One, you want to monitor and trap to
Hello everyone, this is Kathy Heidenreich. Apparently we've lost the connection. If you'll hold on, hopefully Mark will be able to reconnect. I'm not sure what's happening today there with the sound. While we're waiting for Mark to try to connect, Bob, are you still here? Maybe we could answer some of those questions.
Sure. Kevin, are the nurseries routinely testing for viruses? At the nursery level, the certifications are all run by the states, and it's up to the individual state what type of test they require. In California, they're doing indicator plants. They're doing some lab testing. We don't have any nurseries in Oregon or Washington that do strawberries anymore. And I'm not sure what the other states are doing. I know that back east, they're doing lab tests as well as grafting tests. But it's state by state what the requirements are. With the National Clean Plant Network, one of the goals is to harmonize the requirements across, you know, for a given commodity. Right now, we're working on blueberry. But we would like to do the same with raspberry, blackberry, and strawberry. So it's on a state-by-state basis what it gets done. Some nurseries do more than is required. Let's see, Pam Fisher, what's being used? As far as I know right now, they're using primarily imidacloprid, various forms of that. Again, it's not something we do any control for in Oregon because it's so rare. But I think the California nurseries are doing imidacloprid, either Admire or I'm not sure what the names of the actual products are. But the Admire, that when they're using the imidacloprid, they also are much more effective on aphids than what they had been using before. So their aphid control actually improved as well. Let's see, any others? Why is there that's Mark's. Why is there no quarantine? I can take a stab at the quarantine one. I think that's because by the time they realized it was here, it was quite widespread up and down, all the way up and down the West Coast. And I think at that point it was probably in Florida as well. Who paid for the 3,600 tests we did? We had a fair amount of funding from industry. Well, from 2003 through 2006, we had about $200,000 from the strawberry industries in Oregon, Washington, British Columbia, and California. California put a lot of money into it for those few years. When Mark's back online, he's the one that told me they were probably losing about $25 million worth of crop per year before they figured out what the problem was.
Okay, I had a phone call from Mark. He's trying to get reconnected. Are there other questions? Pam has another question.
What does it cost per test? I think it probably costs us, bare bones, is about $5 a test. But if you're doing PCR, that first test costs $5. The second one is probably more like a dollar. So when you're doing nine, you figure a minimum of about $14 or $15 per sample. If you're doing ELISA test, it's less expensive. And for the aphid-borne viruses, what I recommend if people are worried about looking at how they're spreading is to just follow strawberry mild yellow edge, because we have an ELISA test. It's one of the most efficiently transmitted. So it's going to be one of the it'll be the first one out there, that and strawberry model. But you can pretty much monitor virus movement by really watching strawberry mild yellow edge in areas where you have a lot of aphids, because that's the one that gets there as fast as anything. And that way you don't have to test for anything. You can also handle, with ELISA, you can handle a lot of samples in a day. Raspberry horntail, Eastern Washington. Not that I know of, but if it was, I wouldn't be the person they would call. I don't really know. Probably best to contact the extension office out in Prosser, Washington. I don't know who, Gwen, I can't think of her name right now, but if you send me an email, I can send you her contact.
Okay, we're still waiting to reconnect with Mark. Meanwhile, Rufus made a comment about imidacloprid.
Yeah,
okay,
and
that's good to know.
Yeah, because I personally don't follow I never make a recommendation for a pesticide because I don't follow the what's registered, what's not registered, changes in registration. In the Northwest, the berry industries combined, all the berries get together and help support somebody at Oregon State University that really follows everything going into IR4, approved through IR4, when registrations are stopped, and he updates the industry every year on what is new coming down the line, what's been approved, what type of approval, if it's a Section 18 or a full approval or a 24C, I guess it is, and also when things are being pulled. And sometimes they vary by state, so I don't make any recommendations.
Okay, we've still not been able to get to Mark reconnected. It's an internet issue on his end. And I have to apologize for that. He had a change in location when we did the earlier test. It was fine. He's actually preparing for an interview immediately after this. So I hope the poor guy's not too stressed out by the whole thing. Are there any other questions for Bob?
So I got a question. Are people seeing the brown marmorated stink bug in any of the small fruit crops in the Northeast or the East Coast?
All right, well, we'll give you time to respond to Bob's question. I wanted to just say thank you for all of you who have participated. And when we are finished today, there will be a link to an exit survey. We would appreciate your input on the possibility of another series and the topics you'd like to have. It's a simple 5-question thing you can do right online. Okay, there's some more people typing, some more information coming in. So if we don't get Mark back in the next few minutes, then we'll shift to the exit screen and you'll be able to do that survey, and I really appreciate your input on that.
Do you have Mark's slideshow?
It's up. It's here. You don't see it?
Oh, I see it.
Yes.
I'm just wondering if Mark doesn't come back on, if we can at least go through it.
I was thinking that also. Oh, Mark, there you are. Wait a minute.
Oh, good. There he is.
Mark, are you back? Mark, can you hear us?
Almost. Can you hear me now?
Yay. Yes, absolutely. I'm so glad.
I got good people here helping me. This has been great. It's been really good.
That's great. Bob answered a bunch of questions, including some of yours.
Excellent. Oh, okay. Thanks, Bob.
Yeah, no problem.
All right. I can't answer any of yours, though. No way.
I just answered the quarantine one. I just did the quarantine one.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay.
All right, then, Mark, whenever you're ready. Bob, I have to say it was somewhat disconcerting because the entire first presentation I had a blank screen. I hope it didn't record like that. Today must be the day for problems with webinars.
Oh, so do I answer the chat questions with by typing or?
No, you can just, yes.
The question is, I think the lack of a quarantine was pure politics, personally. It's hard to say, just because the spread of the fly was so rapid. I know when we first had large infestations in California, some states weren't really interested. I know Oregon was making some noises about a quarantine, but within days, they also had large infestations of it. So it spread so quickly. But again, not being that close to the regulatory side, I can't say more than that.
Okay, Mark, are you ready to continue?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Go for it.
Okay. Oh, to finish the presentation? It's done. So this is the last. So we're using enhanced sanitation to reduce numbers of flies remaining in the field. And that concludes my talk. Yeah. We good? Any more questions? I'll go back to slide 4. Okay, I see. All right, Pam. This one? Start. Wait, you want me to start here? Wait. Okay. I'm not sure what to do, Kathy. Do you want me to go over the whole talk again from slide 4?
Mark, I think on the presentation, at the end of this slide is where you cut out.
At the end of this slide?
You cut out right at the end of the history slide.
Okay. All right. Okay. I will continue then. Okay, everybody, can you hear me now? Bob, you can hear me, right? So I will do this a little bit briefer than I did the last time. But the keys, so that what we arrived at were keys to successful management of spotted wing drosophila. It's a three-step process of monitoring and trapping to quickly detect infestations. Secondly, use of sprays once those infestations are discovered. And then thirdly, the application of a cultural control, namely enhanced sanitation, reduced numbers of flies remaining field. So monitoring and trapping for spotted wing drosophila, Ed and I tested many, many different types of baits. We tested things, many different purees of many fruits. We tried beer, we tried bananas, we tried methyl, we tried commercial field fly baits. But really, the two baits, and definitely for us, the yeast sugar water is the one that works the best. You can see the recipe right here. It's one package of baker's yeast. That's a quarter ounce Fleischmann's baker's yeast package that you can get at the store. 12 inches, 12 ounces of water, 4 teaspoons of sugar, and that will be enough to fill 4 or 5 traps. The other one, and that is apparently working better for cherry growers, small fruit growers in the Central Valley, is apple cider vinegar. That one sometimes works well for us, other times it does not. What are you doing with a trap like this? You look at the results of a yeast sugar water trap right here, looking at the top of it. You can definitely see the spots on the backs of the wings of those males. There's some other flies mixed in. You see these two over here to the left, probably house flies. So it's very easy to distinguish in these traps what you have. And you don't have to search for some thick goop or do microscopic evaluations. It's a nice system for identifying very quickly what you have in your field. Looking at what the trap looks out in the field, we've got a glass mason jar. Sometimes food safety issues come up with this. We're using it right now for our population monitoring study. And the lid, there's 4 holes in the lid that are 1/8 of an inch in diameter. It's a screw-on lid, and using a wire, piece of wire there to hang it off of the stake. And the Tupperware container over the top of this is to keep out the rain. So that's what that trap looks like. There's about 100 mils of water in there. Spraying to control spotted wing Drosophila. Chemical sprays for spotted wing Drosophila management. What works well is, so I'll just continue. Okay, chemical sprays which work well for us is Malathion, Mustang, and Delegate. These three, we screen quite a few materials. Malathion is an organophosphate, Mustang is a pyrethroid, and Delegate is spinetoram. Rotate these materials to preserve their efficacy. Work OK is in Trust, Pyganic, and Azadirect, and this is in the organic space. Trust is spinosyn, Pyganic is pyrethrin. Let me just ask, who can hear me right now?
Mark, I can hear you.
You can hear me? Okay. All right, we're good. So I'll keep going. All right, thanks, guys. And then, again, recognize that I have tested a whole list of chemicals, and that continues to go. Thank you, guys, for writing in. I appreciate that. Okay, so let's continue on. A note regarding the efficacy of spinosyn's Delegate Radiant Success in the Trust. I think we can enhance the efficacy of these materials by making the fly actually ingest it. They wouldn't obviously eat that just on its own, but if you mix it with some kind of a bait, such as Nulure, or maybe even acetic acid, it may work. But understand, too, that the spinosyns don't last as long when you have them in an acidic medium. So if you are putting a bait like Nulure or acetic acid in your tank, you need to buffer that, or you need to use lesser amounts. Do not go below pH 6.5 when using these materials. You're gonna force down the efficacy. So organic management, again, 20% of the California caneberry industry is organic, and then 5% of the strawberry industry is organic, and that's a lot of acres. So we do need to address the concerns of the organic industry as well. Organic as a direct and a trust, they gave us some control, but it wasn't sufficient. What I did last year is use them repeatedly and try and trust again, because I had some concerns about the first time we did it. It did seem that two closely spaced maximum ripe Pyganic applications plus or minus Azadirect gave us significant control of what up to 1 week. So we may be putting a dent in the population growth. Maybe with 3 applications we get even more. I don't know, but I would expect so. Single and Trust gives the same one to watch, but again, let's watch the resistance on this. Sanitation, this is the third step of the integrated pest management program. Sanitation is going to be key. And again, this slide is double. Implementing sanitation. A couple years ago, this site right here in California, caneberries, was pretty common, and it wasn't really a worry. We've got a leaking pipe there, lots of water on the ground, and then we got a lot of old fruit on top. So we have the keys for spotted wing Drosophila propagation, moisture, old fruit. That we can no longer have. What we're looking for now is this. Nice and dry on the top, if it's possible, and you also notice the total absence of culled fruit laying around the bottom. This is how raspberries, and for that matter blackberries, are harvested in California. You can see at the upper part of the slide the plastic. This is in a tunnel. That gentleman is harvesting fruit. In the years previous, these coffee cans right here, each one of them would have a 2-quart ice cream container in it, and every one of those would have marketable fruit. But in these days, with spotted wing Drosophila, what we're doing now is reserving one of those buckets for collecting cull fruit. A lot of growers have been implementing this. I should caution, we have not tested this empirically. We need to set up a trial to prove it, but it makes a lot of sense. By removing the cull fruit from the field, is we are removing the potential for the fly to complete its life cycle. But we need to test that out as well. This is what one grower has done. You can see, again, we've got some moisture on the top, but again, do notice the absolute absence of old fruit on the surface of the soil. So recommendations, again, to review, recommendations, use of an effective bait at regular intervals in the fruiting field to detect initial entrance in the field. The yeast sugar water was good, and the apple cider vinegar also worked quite well. Those are the two that work good for us. Next, you see, I mentioned protein baits. We're kind of off that one now. Pesticides, Malathion, Mustang, and Delegate are very effective in controlling spotted wing Drosophila. Again, underline, let's rotate those, and also let's apply those in a way that we don't hurt our bee populations. We have a lot of bees in caneberries and strawberries. Apply at night, make sure it's dry, and lessen the impact on bees, because those pyrethroids, that organophosphate, and indeed spinetoram will have effect on bee populations. Organic growers, high frequent rates of pyganic or entrust work. Same holds true about the beneficials with these too. Sanitation, lastly, removal and destruction of infested fruit will be essential in keeping down total numbers of flies. So those are the three steps, and that completes it, and I hope you could all hear me.
Okay, Mark, there's a few questions. Do you have time to answer those?
Yeah, I'm good. I got about 10 minutes.
Okay, and Bob, if there are any questions for Bob, feel free to jump in. So, Mark, Kevin Schooley would like to know where the best placement for traps is.
Okay, yeah, best placement for traps, we'd like to put about 5 out per acre, I think is good, and I would put them towards the inside of the field. And you can see, I wouldn't put them at the top. Spotted wing Drosophila doesn't like it when it's so bright. Put it down in the darker part. Don't put it all the way at the bottom. You know, definitely don't put it on your drip tape. Maybe 2-3 feet off the surface of the soil. And then for strawberries, you can use like an old margarine container or something like that and do the same and just stand it in the field. But you really need to be putting it in where there's shade and moisture. That's going to be where most of the flies are.
Are there any other questions for our speakers today? Thank you so much, both Bob and Mark, and thank you, everyone, for putting up with our connection issues. And, Mark, good luck with your interview. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks. Hey, thanks for the opportunity. Take care.
Thanks, everybody.